ओके, इज माय वॉइस ओके? मोहम्मद इरशाद, दर्शना एंड रेंसी. ओके, सो लेट्स वेट फॉर 2 more minutes. लेट अदर्स ज्वाइन द क्लास एंड देन वी आर गोइंग टू स्टार्ट विद अ न्यू चैप्टर. एंड आफ्टर वी हैव कवर्ड फ्यू पार्ट्स ऑफ इट, सम पार्ट्स ऑफ इट, वी आर गोइंग टू स्विच ओवर टू द पेपर एंड वी आर गोइंग टू डिस्कस द पेपर विच वी हैव डन यस्टरडे. फाइन, सो लेट्स वेट फॉर 2 minutes. ओके, वी आर गोइंग टू वेट फॉर 2 minutes. लेट अदर्स ज्वाइन द क्लास टू एंड देन वी आर गोइंग टू स्टार्ट विद द क्लास. फाइन, मोहम्मद इरशाद, दर्शना एंड रेंसी. Is it clear? Lindsay, it clear? Please respond in the chat box itself. Fine. So we are going to start with a new chapter. Everyone out there, I hope I am able to reach you properly in terms of voice. Okay, once we have done some of part of it, okay, then we are going to start with the we are going to discuss the paper we have solved yesterday in class itself. Okay, so I hope you are able to see the board properly. Is everyone able to see the board properly? Please let me know in the chat box. Great. So in the working life, employees do get dissatisfied with various aspects of working, maybe with the attitude of the manager, policy of the company, working conditions, or behavior of colleagues, right? Employers try to ignore or suppress grievances, right? But they cannot be suppressed for long. Grievances act as rust which corrodes the very fabric of organization, okay? An aggrieved employee is a potent source of indiscipline and bad working. According to Julius, a grievance is any discontent or dissatisfaction, whether expressed or not, whether valid or not, okay, arising out of anything connected with the company which employs things, believes, or even seems to be unfair, unjust, or inequitable. Now, you know what happens in an organization? We all of us work in an organization, so sometimes we get dissatisfied with something. So it is going to lead to a grievance. okay, sometimes our grievance may be based on, you know, can be true. Sometimes it can be based on the preconceived notion, sometimes it can be correct, sometimes it can be incorrect. But if I am having grievances towards the company and if company is trying to suppress it, you know, it is going to affect the quality of my work, right? I will never do justice with the work I had been given, right? So it should not be suppressed. Instead, they should try to, you know, resolve the grievance, right? Okay, now I think I haven't taught this earlier, right? I don't think I have taught this earlier, right? Muhammad Irshad, Darshana, Rinsey, and Kelvin. I don't think I have taught this earlier, right? Okay, wait. Let me check. Wait, just wait for a while. Yeah, this is a new one only, not the old one. 6613. Yeah, this is a new one. Yeah, great. Okay, so this set is, to understand what grievance is, you must clearly see if you see grievance is a different thing, complaint is a different thing, okay, and dissatisfaction is something else. So we should understand the difference in between all three of these. Now, dissatisfaction, anything that disturbs an employee, okay. Whether or not the unrest is expressed in words, okay. So if something is disturbing me, okay, you can speak about your dissatisfaction towards something, or you can just keep it within yourself, okay. Complaint is a spoken or written dissatisfaction brought to the attention of the supervisor or shop steward, fine. And grievance is a complaint that has been formally presented to a management representative or to a union official. Fine. So dissatisfaction is I am dissatisfied with something. Complaint is like you you either speak about your dissatisfaction or you give it in written, okay, to the supervisor. You brought it. And grievance is when a complaint has been given formally. If this dissatisfaction takes a formal shape, okay, we report it to the management formally, okay, then it would be a grievance. Fine? Is it clear, everyone? Mohammed Irshad, Darshana, Renzi, Kelvin, and Rishi. Clear? Is it clear what is the difference between the three? That is dissatisfaction, complaint, and grievance. Any questions, anyone? In addition, there are other definitions of a grievance that distinguish it from other three. Few such definitions are, a grievance is a formal dispute between an employer and management on the conditions of employment. These definitions have been quoted out by or chalked out by certain scientists. I mean, people who might have, I mean, who are specialized in this area. Grievances are complaints that has been formally registered in accordance with the grievance procedure, right? So grievances like, when your dissatisfaction takes a formal turn, you report it to the management in the form of a formal email or written letter, then it would be a grievance. A grievance is any dissatisfaction or feeling of injustice in connection with one's employment situation that is brought to the attention of the management, and that too in a formal manner. Fine. Therefore, you will see that grievance is a formal and relatively drastic step compared to dissatisfaction and complaint. See, complaint is something else. See, it's informal. I'm complaining about something. But when it comes to grievance, okay, then that means that it has been reported to the management that, okay, I'm dissatisfied with this, okay, and you have reported it to the management in a formal manner. There is a way you follow. So if you report something in a formal manner to the management, that would be a grievance. When dissatisfaction takes the form of grievance, you report it to the management in a formal manner. Fine, Darshana. However, instances where complaints turn into grievances are not common, since few employees will question their superior's judgment. Further, many people do not initiate grievances because they fear negative consequences as a result of their attempt. So see, many people, they are not going to initiate grievances. If some company is doing something wrong with them, they'll just stay quiet, you know, because, you know, they think that if they'll think that, okay, if I'm going to do it, these people are going to sue me for this. I might lose my job, right? Right? So that's why, you know, they are going to sit mum. You know, many people of that kind you are going to find in the company these days. Now, Kazi Sabinur Hasnat, are you there? I guess this is your first class, right? And hi, Sanobar, how are you? Kazi, is this your first class? Okay, so Kazi, welcome to the class. I would request you to be regular in class so that, you know, your attendance is not affected, because if your attendance is not up to the mark, then your grades will be affected. Okay, and if at any point of time you're not able to follow anything, just raise your hand, or you can even, you know, write down your queries in the chat box itself. Fine. So I teach three subjects. First of all, I teach case studies for various subjects. Secondly, I teach business communication, and I also teach HR. Okay, so today we are dealing with a chapter in HR itself. Now, features. If we analyze these definitions of grievances, some noticeable features emerge clearly. A grievance refers to any form of discontent, right? Or dissatisfaction with any aspect of the organization, right? The dissatisfaction might rise out of employment and not due to personal or family problems. So see, if I am launching, if I am having a grievance, it's not like I am having personal reasons for that. I might be agitated over my manager or over some policies in the company. So grievance means dissatisfaction, right, everyone? Dissatisfaction of any kind, right? Right, everyone? Any questions? Okay. Now, the dissatisfaction, but okay, the discontent can carry out of real or imaginary reasons. Sometimes our dissatisfaction is based on real reasons, right? But sometimes, you know, we are prejudiced about something, and we may take, you know, we may develop a wrong opinion about it. So that grievance will be due to imaginary reasons, which doesn't exist at all, but you are thinking about it. Fine. Hi, Sunil, how are you? Yeah, me good too. So today we are doing about grievances, okay? And later on we are going yes. Now, see, we are learning about a new chapter. First, we are going to complete a few parts of it, and then we are going to discuss the paper. Fine, Sunil. And hi, Meenu, how are you? I hope you are doing well. I guess this is your first class, Meenu. Okay. Now, when the employee feels that injustice has been done, he has a grievance. The reasons for such a feeling may be valid. Sometimes, you know, we feel that injustice has been done, but it has not been done in real, right? So that for that kind of injustice, you know, we are going to hold anger towards the company, right, for that. But, you know, reason is not valid, right? Okay, Meenu, welcome to the class. I will request you to be regular in class, because if your attendance is not up to the mark, you will lose grades. Okay, and moreover, I would request you to lay down your queries in the chat box if you have one, if you are not able to follow anything. Fine, Meenu. Hi, Prabhavati, good evening. You are a bit late today. Okay. Okay, fine. Okay, okay. No issues. Okay. Now, when the employee feels that injustice has been done to him, he has a grievance. The reasons for such a feeling may be valid or invalid, legitimate or irrational, justiciable, so justifiable or ridiculous. Fine. So, if you are holding a grievance, so reason could be legitimate. That means it's up to the mark. But sometimes you develop grievance out of your own prejudices, right? Right, everyone? So that is not valid. The discontent may be voiced or unvoiced. So if the discontent is voiced, that means I am raising a voice against discontent, but it may find expression in some form. However, discontent per is not a grievance. Initially, the employer may complain orally or in writing. If it is not looked upon into promptly, the employer feels a sense of, see, if I have a grievance, I am giving it to the my team leader in written or the management of my management in written. And if they are not taking care of that, what is going to happen? I will feel that, I don't think so. Others are saying we haven't done it. Others are saying we haven't done it. So that's why I'm doing it. I don't think, I'm not able to recall actually. That's why I asked them earlier. But others are saying not, we haven't done, so I started up with this. What should we do, O Prabha? Let's do some parts of it, okay? And then we are going to change the topic. Fine? It's okay? Fine. Broadly speaking, the grievances are traceable to perceived non-fulfillment of one expectations from organization. So see, if I feel that organization should do something, and if it is not being fulfilled, then I will have grievance towards the organization. Clear? Is it clear? And we also have to discuss the last time's paper, which we have studied yesterday. So we are going to, do that as well. Okay? Today itself. Fine, everyone? All right. So now what we will do, I'll tell you what we are going to do. Just wait for a while, please. All right, I'm going to put it here itself. All right. Okay, so I'm going to put the next topic on the board. As the Bhagati is saying, we have done it earlier. So last time we were doing, this thing, understanding teams. And we still need to do types of teams we have covered. Yeah, we have done that. So let's get started with the new chapter. See, we will do managing in a global environment. We are going to start with this. Okay, the international environment, functions of the international manager, the multinational corporation, personal challenges for global managers. Let's start with this topic. Okay, so I'm going to put the itinerary for that. Okay, what we're going to cover. Okay, and I haven't received the papers. I hope you have sent it to the coordinator because I need to correct them. Yeah, I'm going to discuss it. I'm going to discuss it. First of all, we are going to start the new chapter. This is what we're going to cover. Okay. Okay, fine. So please pay heed to the board. First of all, we are going to do this chapter, the international environment. So every company does a business abroad. See, most of the MNCs, most of the companies which are there in India now, okay? What is going to happen, you are going to find offices abroad as well. They get a lot of business from abroad, right? Like companies like Accenture, then there are so many companies. They get business from abroad, right? So that's why, most of the companies, they run in three shifts. You can choose for three shifts, morning, afternoon, and evening shift, right, everyone? Right, everyone? Raisa, Sunil, please respond. Meenu, Sandeep, Kelvin, Renzi, Darshana, Mohammed. Okay, so international managers face intense and constant challenges that require training and understanding of the foreign environment. See, if I'm working with someone in Russia, okay, if I'm an international manager and I am doing business with someone in Russia, then I should understand their etiquette and then I can behave with them well. So, these international managers, they face a lot of, continuous and intense challenges. Managing a business in a foreign country requires managers to deal with a large variety of cultural and environmental differences. See, every country will have a cultural difference. So a manager who is doing business with Russia, he has to learn the culture of Russia first, then only he can deal with them accordingly, right? As a result, international managers must continuously monitor the political, legal, socio-cultural, economic, and technological environment. Fine? Now the political environment. The political environment can foster or hinder the economic development and direct investment. See, nowadays the relation in between Pakistan and India is not good. So if an international manager is dealing with Pakistan, they will have to face a lot of challenges because the person who is sitting in Pakistan, they won't be happy. See, what they will also, they will have some kind of hatred with for Indian, and same is applicable to Indian as well, owing to the political environment, right? So because of that, lot of challenges are being met out. I mean, they have to face a lot of challenges. The relation between India and China is also not very good. So if I'm doing business with China, being an international manager for some company, okay, then I'll have to face a lot of challenge for that as well. This environment is ever changing. As examples, the political and economic philosophies of nation leader may change overnight. So sometimes, like I am doing business with a suppose particular country, okay, being an international manager, and if they are getting a new government and they are changing all the policies, and if I'm not keeping myself updated on that, I won't be able to do business with them, right? Because policies change overnight, okay, right? The stability of a nation, okay. The stability of a nation's government, which frequently rests on the support of the people, yeah, can be very volatile. Various citizen groups with vested interests can underdetermine investment operations and opportunities, and local government may view foreign firms suspiciously, right? Right, everyone? Political considerations are seldom written down and often change rapidly. For example, to protest Iraq's invasion of Kuwait in 1990, many world governments levied economic sanctions against the import of Iraqi oil, right? So political considerations affect international business a lot, right? Because if politics, obviously due to politics, the government is going to change. If they are passing on some policies on, overnight, it might affect your business. You might have chalked out everything in paper, how you're going to deal with them, and if they have changed policies overnight, you'll have to change your, policies too, right? Your plans too. As government enacts tariffs, taxes, quotas, embargoes, blockages, and other types of restriction in response to political events. Okay? Suppose, there is a change of government in a particular country overnight, and now they don't want to do business with people of my country. They have put a ban on that. In that case, what is going to happen? If me being the international manager, what is going to happen? I won't be allowed to do business with them. They are never going to do business with me, right? So these are the challenges which is being faced by international managers. Business engaged in international trade must consider the relative instability of countries such as Iraq, South Africa, and Honduras. Political unrest in the countries such as Peru, Haiti, Somalia, and the countries of the former Soviet Union may create hostile or even dangerous environments for foreign businesses. In Russia, for example, foreign managers often need to hire bodyguards, right? 16 foreign business people were murdered there in 1993. So there is a threat of life as well, right? When you're doing business with certain countries, right? There is a threat of life as well. Right? There is a girl from Pakistan, Malala, right? She got actually the Nobel Prize this time, right? So many people are, against her now, right? And these people, terrorists, are saying that if she is going to come back to Pakistan, we are going to kill her, right? So this kind of thing may happen, right? Civil war, as in Chechnya and Bosnia, may disrupt business activities and places lives in danger. And a sudden change in power can result in a regime that is hostile to foreign investment. Nowadays, there is a lot of resentment in USA because these people are losing jobs, and so they, when Obama came, once there was a rumor when Obama joined as US president, there was a rumor that he is going to stop all outsourcing business because people are furious. Their people are not getting jobs, and they are saying that why you are outsourcing it to India? We are jobless, right? So if they are going to stop outsourcing, all the BPOs will, come to an end, right? Okay, and a sudden change in power. So if there is a change in power, government or policies, okay, obviously it is going to affect the international business, right? suppose one country is having very good relations with the other country, okay, and all of a sudden they fight breaks out in between them, then obviously international trade will be affected in that case, right? Some businesses may be forced out of country altogether. Whether they like it or not, companies are often involved directly or indirectly in international politics. Clear? Is it clear? Everyone? Any questions for me? Anyone out there? The legal environment. The American federal government has put forth a number of laws that regulate the activities of U.S. firms engaged in international trade. However, once outside U.S. borders, American organizations are likely to find that the laws of the other nations differ from that of U.S. Many legal rights that Americans take for granted does not exist in other countries. A U.S. firm doing business abroad must understand and obey the laws of the host country. So if some company is coming into my country, they have to follow the laws of my country, right? So they might have chalked out policies which is favorable for them in their country, but it might not be applicable in the other country. So they'll have to change their policies altogether, right? In U.S., the acceptance of bribes or payoff is illegal. In other countries, the acceptance of bribes or payoff may not be illegal. They may consider a common business practice, right? In addition, some countries have copyrights and patent laws that are less strict than those in U.S., and some countries fail to honor these laws. China, for example, has recently been threatened with severe trade sanctions because of the history of allowing American goods to be copied or counterfeited there. So, you know, Chinese people, they actually copy the, you know, inventions of U.S. people and people in India, and they sell it at a very, very, you know, like less price, right? So this is a, if they are doing the same thing in America, they will be sued for that. But it doesn't happen in China, right? As a result, business engaging in international trade may need to take extra steps to protect their products because local laws may be insufficient to protect them, right? Is it clear? Any questions? Okay. All right. The economic environment. Managers must monitor currency, infrastructure, inflation, interest rates, wages, and taxation. See, every day, you know, the exchange rate is going to go up or go down, right? So you have to continuously, because of the stock market. The stock markets are very volatile. So, economic environment changes every now and then, right? Currency, infrastructure, inflation rates, interest rates, wages. In assessing the economic environment in foreign countries, a business must pay particular attention to the following four areas. Average income level of the population. Somebody is scrolling it down. I don't know who they are. Okay. If the average income for the population is very low, no matter how desperately this population needs a product or service, there simply is no market for it. So see, if their average income is low and if they need it, they won't be able to pay you for the same. So there is no point in doing business with them, right? Tax structure. In some countries, foreign firms pay much higher taxes than domestic competitors, right? These tax differences may be obvious or subtle as in hidden registration fee. Inflation rate. In the US, for example, inflation rates have been quite low and relatively stable for several years. In some countries, however, inflation rates of 30, 40, or even 100% per year are not uncommon. Inflation results in a general rise in the level of prices and impacts business in many ways, right? For example, in mid-70s, a shortage of crude oil led to numerous problems because petroleum products supply most of the energy required to produce goods and services and to transport goods around the world, right? As the cost of petroleum products increased, a corresponding increase took place in the cost of goods and services, right? So if there is a hike in the price of the petroleum products, obviously there will be a hike in the price of cost of goods. As a result, interest rates increased dramatically, causing both business and consumers to reduce their borrowing. Right? I'll come to it, Baba. Okay? Business profits fell as consumers' purchasing power was eroded by inflation. Okay? High interest rates and unemployment reached alarmingly high levels. Fine? And even exchange rates fluctuates a lot. Right? The exchange rate or the value of one country's currency in terms of another country's currency is determined primarily by supply and demand for each country's goods and services. The government of a country can, however, cause this exchange rate to change dramatically by causing high inflation, by printing too much currency, or by changing the value of the currency through devaluation. A foreign investor may sustain large losses if the value of the currency drops substantially, right? When doing business abroad, business people need to recognize that they cannot be taken for granted that other countries offer the same things as found in industrialized nations. A country's level of development is often determined in part by its infrastructure. Okay, so the infrastructure is the physical facilities that supports a country's economic activity, right? Such as railroads. Okay, fine. I'll just come back, okay? Just give me 2 minutes. I'll just come back from the washroom. Back. Thanks for waiting. Okay. The infrastructure is the physical facility that supports country's economic activities such as railroads, highways, ports, utilities, and power plants, schools, hospitals, communication systems, commercial distribution systems. When doing business in less developed country, a business may need to compensate for rudimentary distribution and communication systems. So if the company, but the country is, you know, less developed, what is going to happen? You know, if they are not having, you know, very good communication systems, I will have to spend extra money on that, right? Yeah. So you have to keep all these stuff in mind while doing, a job. You know, if government may take abrupt decisions, which may, you know, so you have to keep yourself, updated on political confront, economic concerns, what is the exchange rate, inflation rate. So that's why the job of an international manager is not that tough, because they have to keep themselves updated on, you know, various things. Laws change every now and then. So the culture is different. So they have to keep in mind many things before, you know, when they are doing business with someone outside, abroad, right? Because inflation rate changes, exchange rate changes every now and then. Political parties are changing, so obviously laws are also going to change. Is it clear? Is this much clear to everyone? Okay. Now, what I want you to do, just read it by your own, on your own, so that you can get the better understanding of this. So for that, you have to read it from here till here, first of all, often. And once you are done with this, we are going to discuss yesterday's paper. Okay? Is it clear what you have to do? So please read it on your own and slowly. With it, Kazi, you have to read it from here till here to get the better understanding of this. Okay, I have already read it for you people. Okay, so now I want you people to read it on your own. Okay, is everyone done with it? Should I scroll it down? Okay, fine. Take your time. No issues. Please take your time. Don't be in a hurry. Just follow it properly. How about others? How about others? Should I scroll it down? Okay. Now you can read the remaining parts of it. Okay. Yeah, read the remaining parts of it, please. Yeah, correct. First, Hinda means human. Correct, Sabhavati. Are you done with it? Should I scroll it down? Okay. Please read the remaining parts of it. You read it from here till general. Fine, everyone? done with it? मोहम्मद इरशाद, दर्शना, रेंसी, केल्विन, अनोबल, सुनील, प्रभावती, सहर, फहाद, नीनू, फारूक, संदीप एंड काजी. आर यू डन? ओके, रीड द लास्ट पार्ट ऑफ इट, द इकोनॉमिक एनवायरनमेंट. हु इज स्क्रोलिंग इट? You have to do the economic environment now. Read it, please. Economic environment by it. Demand that word. Till here. Yeah. Done. Done. If you have completed it, please let me know in the chat box. Okay, fine. Okay. Now, Darshana, we are going to do the question. We are going to discuss the question paper we have covered yesterday. Okay. So, let me put the question paper first on the board. Okay. Okay. So, and then I'm going to share the answer. Fine. Now, so first of all, we have done this question and this question, right? Objectives of human resource planning, right? So what are the objectives of human resource planning? What you have written as answer? Objectives of human resource planning. See, HRP, I'll tell you what are the objectives. See, objectives of when it comes to the objectives of human resource planning, I'm going to sum it up in the form of, you know, like points. Okay. So objectives of human resource planning are these: recruit and maintain the HR of requisite quantity and quality, right? To predict the employee turnover and make the arrangement for minimizing. So see, if the employees are less, they have to keep it, you know, they have to keep the track record of how many employees they have. If it is going down, obviously they have to fill the consequent vacancy, right? To meet the requirement of the program of expansion, diversification, okay? So, okay, to anticipate the impact of technology on both existing employees and future human resource requirements, fine? To progress the knowledge, skills, standard, ability, and discipline. So there should not be an imbalance in the company in terms of number of employees. So this is what they do in real. Fine? In short. Fine? If they are surplus employees, they have to cut it down. If there are, you know, there is a shortage of employees, then they have to recruit more. Fine? Clear? Is it clear, everyone? Prabhavati, others, is it clear? Now, what is job description? State the uses of job description. So see, first of all, the question is, what is job description? Okay? And uses of job description. Like, okay? Alright. See, job description is like where they put in, you know, the human resource managers, you know, when they give the job description, why do they give it? The question is, why do they give it? Because so that they can, you know, choose the appropriate employee through that, right? Right? Okay, so this is a very easy question, right? Job description, right, Prabhavati? Another? So what you people have written? See, when it comes to a well-written job description, it not only, you know, describes what they need in real. So the, see, it's the proper, it should be there in, you know, this is the attribute of a good human resource department. They should be able to, you know, put in, when they are, you know, putting in the job description anywhere, whether it's a site or a newspaper, they have to make sure it's concrete and as per the requirement. Okay, so that, you know, they can you know, attract the appropriate employees, okay, who really are supposed to do that job, who are really supposed to be, I mean, who have got the key, you know, like, who have got the key, we can say this thing, okay, I have forgotten that word, yeah, who have got the key skills which are being needed for that position, fine? Okay, let's switch over to the next one. Now. Okay. Oh, we have done this. Fringe benefits we have discussed. Okay. Causes of indiscipline, objectives of performance appraisal. This also we have done. Elements of recruitment policy. Yes or no? Can you hear me now? Can you hear me now? Is my voice okay? Okay, so principles of training. Now, let's deal with principles of training. So what you have written under that answer, principles of training. Principles of training, what all things you have written under that? Yes, everyone. What all things you have written under that? Please let me know. Yeah. Anyone? Principles of training. You haven't attended that question or what? Training policy. What else? What else? Purpose. Yeah. So see, whenever they design the training policy, you know, principles of training is they should be clear when it comes to objective, right? If they don't have got a correct you know, definition of objective, then in that case, what is going to happen? They won't be able to design the appropriate policy, right? Right? Okay. So those things you have to put under that. Okay. Principles of training. Now, next question. Yes. What are the causes of indiscipline? Causes of indiscipline. They might be having grievance because of that. Okay. They might, you know, the company might not be motivating. In that case, they start showing indiscipline. Right. So sometimes, you know, causes of undiscipline can be many. Unfair management practices like wage discrimination could be there. The quality of environment at the workplace might not be good. Okay, there must be delay in this thing, wages and all. Defective handling of grievances. Communication barriers might be there, right? Right leadership might not be there. Defective supervision can be the reason, right? Divide and rule policy could be there, absence of code of conduct. There can be so many reasons because of which, you know, they can be, you know, this could be the reason for indiscipline. Okay? Fine? So I'm going to put it on the board. Okay? Okay. All right. So this is the answer. Okay? You can even copy it. Okay, from the board. So we are done for today. Okay, we are going to discuss rest of the things in tomorrow's class. So please be there. I hope I was able to do justice to the subject. If you have some grievances, don't just hold it within yourself as per the chapter. Just try to put it down on the in the you know feedback form so that I can take care of that. Okay, and just put the you know like appropriate comments there. Whatever you feel about the class in general. Okay, and if you want me to cover something specific in class, any suggestions are also welcome. If you want me to employ something, as Prabha suggested yesterday that I should, you know, discuss the paper in class itself. So just let me know that also. Okay, so thank you so much. See you tomorrow. Just try to be on time and try to be regular. Okay, thank you so much. Take care. Bye.